Morning. Today's Old Testament reading is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. You can find this in your Pew Bible on pages 609 and 610. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. And then I said, 'Oh, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy.' But the Lord said to me, 'Do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord.' Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, 'Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant.'" Today's gospel lesson is in the book of Luke, chapter 13, verses 10 through 17, and this can be found on page 848 in your Pew Bible. Okay, one second. "Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, 'Woman, you are set free from your ailment.' When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, 'There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, but not on the Sabbath day.' But the Lord answered him and said, 'You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?' When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame. And the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing."
Many of you know that I volunteered at a Christian community outside of Atlanta, Georgia, back in the early 2000s, a Christian community called Jubilee Partners, where I taught English as a second language to refugees primarily from Africa. And one of the things that we would do as volunteers every couple months is we would travel to a monastery, a Trappist monastery, in Conyers, Georgia, and we would have a time of retreat at this monastery. And each time that we traveled to this monastery in Conyers, we had a chance to meet with the abbot, the head monk. And this gentleman's name was Father Francis Michael. He was quite a character. Father Francis Michael, in the course of his life, had met Mother Teresa twice. Not once, but twice. And the first time he met her, actually both times he met her, he was absolutely certain that God was calling him to work with her and her ministries in Calcutta. Each time he met her, he said, "Mother Teresa, I know God wants me to work with you." Imagine someone volunteering, saying to Mother Teresa, "I want to come work with the lepers, the poor in Calcutta." And I would, if someone said that to me, "Lori, I want to come and just volunteer all my time at the church," I think I'd be really happy. So you'd sort of think Mother Teresa would be happy. But each time that she met him, he met her twice, she said, "No, this is not God speaking, this is you speaking. God is calling you, but not here, not to India, and not to work with me. "Go away and listen to God." She said this to Father Francis Michael twice. "Go away and listen to God." Sometime after one of his meetings with Mother Teresa, he was taking a cross-country motorcycle ride, driving from his native Pennsylvania, just meandering around the country. And he stopped, he thought it would be briefly, at this Trappist monastery in Georgia. He tells the story that when he pulled in and got off his motorcycle, he knew in that moment that God was calling him there, to stay there, to be a monk, to be a priest, and eventually to be the abbot. When he went back home, he said to his motorcycle friends, and he, as again, as he tells the story, he said, "These are friends I got into a lot of trouble with." They said to him, "Wait, you're doing what? You're going where? You're going to be a monk? Did you say a monk?" And Father Francis Michael said that his response was always, "You think you're surprised? I have to go and live there." That's how it is with God. That's how it can be with God. God catches up with you in places you least expect, calls you at the least expected times. The idea of being called by God is common to clergy. Clergy are supposed to feel called to the ministry. When I first came here to Londonderry, I was called as your interim minister and then as your settled pastor. Always that word called, called by God. But the first scripture, the lesson from Jeremiah, doesn't limit it to clergy, doesn't limit it to pastors. Jeremiah wasn't a minister. Neither was Moses or Isaiah or Amos or Jonah, and they were all called by God. I could have titled this sermon, "You Are Called by God." And if you had read that, you might have sat in your pew and thought, "Oh, that's nice. She thinks I'm called by God." It is a nice thought. But I want you to more than just hold it in your head for a moment during this sermon, I invite you to hold that in your heart and mind and spirit. You are called by God. I think any advice from Mother Teresa is good. So I want you to hold two things. You are called by God, and go away and listen to God. In the scripture lesson this morning, the first words we hear from young Jeremiah when he announces that he is called is, "Wait, I'm only a boy." Jeremiah protests. And maybe words of protest are forming in your mind. Called by God? No way. But if you're protesting, that's good, because all the great ones called by God protested. Amos said, "I am only a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. You can't call me." Jonah tried to run when God called Jonah. So if you're thinking, "I'm not called by God," you're in very good company. Jeremiah is called to speak God's word. To speak God's word of love and mercy and justice and repentance. And Jeremiah says, "But I'm only a boy." And God said, "Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you're not comfortable talking to people. Get over it. It's not about your comfort. It's about being called by God." And God's promise in the scripture to Jeremiah, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you. Those whom God calls, God equips." One theologian offers this comment: "You are where you are on purpose. God does not move by accident. God has assigned you where you are. You are there because God has set you in place, set you there that God might be glorified in and through you." If you're wondering, called for what? That's the best answer you're going to get. Because finding out is the whole point. I wish I could say, "Rejoice, you're called by God, kick up your heels." But it's not always easy to be called by God. And it's certainly not always easy to listen to God. Maybe we want to work with the poor and lepers in Calcutta, But God has a different idea. God wants you, like Father Francis Michael, to be a Trappist monk. I will remind you of one thing. God says to Jeremiah, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you." God's words to Jeremiah and God's words to us. God may have set you as a teacher or a builder or an artist or an astronomer or a mother or father, someone who cannot speak well or see well or hear well. God may have set you as someone who loves to play golf or is very good with money or flowers or coffee hour or providing eggs to the church. You may be someone with a fragile ego or short temper or good at sailing. You may be someone who is new to faith. God has set you here, and God is with you in whatever you and God figure out you are called to do. There was a period of time when Father Francis Michael would say at the beginning of each day, "What do you want to do today, God?" He really viewed it as a team effort. "Holy God, what do you call me to this day?" If we are serious about invoking the Holy Spirit, if we are serious about asking God to come and be with us, if we are serious about trying to be God's faithful people, we are invited to trust that God is present and that the Holy Spirit is working with us and through us, just like Jeremiah. This past week, one of the great Christian writers of our time, Frederick Buechner, was gathered into God's loving arms at the age of 96, and he lived in Rupert, Vermont. And he wrote these words about listening for God. He offered that listening for God begins by listening to your life. These are Frederick Buechner's words. "Listen to your life. See it for the fathomless mystery it is. Whenever you find tears in your eyes," he writes, "especially unexpected tears, it is well to pay the closest attention. Because more often than not, God is speaking to you through them of the mystery of where you have come from and is summoning you to where you should go next. Listen to your life. Listen to tears, especially the unexpected. That is where God is calling you. Go away this morning realizing that you have God's word in your mouth. Go away and listen to your life. Go away and listen for God. And do not be afraid, for God walks with you always. Amen."